ओके सो दिस इज अ वीडियो ऑन सॉवरेन वेल्थ फंड, अ पार्ट ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूशनल आईपीएस सीएफए लेवल 3. नाउ सॉवरेन वेल्थ फंड वाज नॉट देयर एज अ टाइप ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूशन इन द सीएफए लेवल 3 करिकुलम एवर. सो इट हैज बीन ब्रॉट इनटू द करिकुलम फॉर 2020 एंड ऑब्वियसली 2021. दैट्स बिकॉज ओवर द लास्ट टू डेकेड्स सॉवरेन वेल्थ फंड्स हैव बीन ग्रोइंग इन इम्पोर्टेंस. You must have heard that the Abu Dhabi fund had taken a stake in Reliance Jio recently. Abu Dhabi fund had taken a stake in Reliance Jio recently. So Abu Dhabi fund is a sovereign wealth fund. Similarly, I don't know how much you keep track of news, but the China Sovereign Wealth Fund had taken a 1.1% stake in HDFC, and then the eyebrows were raised that perhaps China is looking at all this as an opportunity to exercise control over several entities, and then the Indian government became very concerned and said that no, all such investments by neighboring countries shall be monitored by India. So Abu Dhabi investing in Reliance Jio, China Sovereign Wealth Fund taking a stake in HDFC, all those are the feelings of where do you hear about Sovereign Wealth Fund. Does India have a Sovereign Wealth Fund? No, India doesn't have a Sovereign Wealth Fund. China has it, UAE has it, Kuwait has it, Norway has it, Canada has it, Russia has it. Okay, India doesn't have a Sovereign Wealth Fund. It is but obvious that sovereign wealth funds are created by states themselves. They are state owned and they will invest in financial assets, real assets, generally across the globe to enjoy geographical diversification. Based on the purpose of sovereign wealth funds, based on the purpose, IMF has classified sovereign wealth funds into 5 categories. Before I go to those categories, as has been our style of teaching, we never try to follow the text, straight away showing you something and I reading out from there. It is not my style. So let's try to build up a case. See, there is a perpetual long cry in India about inadequate infrastructure, any type of infrastructure. India lacks infrastructure and everybody knows it. So if government sets up a sovereign wealth fund in India by an act of parliament with tax exemption, and the purpose of this fund will be to look at infrastructure development for the next 10-20 years. Okay, infrastructure development. Don't you think it would be wonderful? This type of fund is called a development fund. It was set up by Iran. So far as I remember, I'll just confirm when I take you to the core. Iran had set up a developmental fund. So IMF has, out of the 5, one category is developmental fund to develop infrastructure. So you get Indian feeling from there. Second is, say, if you consider India's foreign exchange reserves, which are exceeding $500 billion, where are these invested? These foreign exchange reserves are invested mainly in US treasury securities, US T-bills. Of course they are safe, but what return are we getting? I doubt. In fact, if dollar depreciates, the returns can be negative, because as of now, beginning August, when I'm recording this class, the T-bills return is around 0.08%. Okay, 0.08%. And if dollar depreciates, as the dollar index had fallen from 105 to 94 levels, and that was only the first leg of the fall, if dollar depreciates, obviously Indian central bank, the RBI, will be finding that it's having a negative cost on its dollar denominated assets. Now, the reason why anybody invests in safe and short-term liquid assets is because of liquidity requirement. Say there's a flight of capital from the Indian economy, as in FIIs pull their money and there's an attack on rupee. So RBI knows that at that time it can sell off its dollar reserves, okay, and try to ensure that it can fight the speculative capital attack. So that sort of conservatism basically drives RBI to do that. Of course, RBI also invests in gold. It also has SDR, special drawing rights. But don't you think that this very, very low return that we are earning, almost negative, is a huge burden on our country, which is a capital-starved economy, wherein huge amount of money is required to develop infrastructure, to develop this and that. So India is not understanding the game that China understood way back in 2007. In 2007, China established its sovereign wealth fund, and the main purpose of the fund was to invest its forex reserves, not in short-term liquid assets, but across the globe, in alternate investments, in equities, public, private, whatever it is. They took that call. They understood the long game going on. India is taking time. It is still operating like we used to operate in 1960s, 70s, 80s, where we consider ourselves to be whatever third world nations and all. So there got to be a dramatic change. Anyways, I will not divert into it. I'm saying all this why? Because when we discuss all this, the retention level goes up. You are able to attach with the topic. So what is going on? I am trying to ensure that you are able to attach to the topic. Otherwise, I can speak names and move ahead. Follow the author. So I started with India because most of my students are Indians. And I said that two types of sovereign wealth funds, which are very, very much related to India, they are development fund and reserve fund. Development fund to develop infrastructure, reserve fund to earn a decent return on our forex reserves. Now, all the commodity rich nations that we have, oil rich nations, who are banking on a particular commodity, the likes of the UAE, Kuwait, Russia, Norway, Venezuela, all these countries, they are banking on their oil reserves. When oil prices go up, they exhibit a budget surplus. When oil prices go down, they display a budget deficit. So their budget surplus and deficit is cyclical in nature, depending upon the cyclicality of oil prices, and you know how much oil has been volatile. So obviously, strategic thinkers in those nations will think, why are we making our budget so much volatile? We should instead have a fund, say budget stabilization fund, and the purpose of this fund will be to stabilize our budget, to ensure that in whichever years we have a budget surplus because of high oil price, that year some money can go into the fund and that fund can be invested in fixed income and cash and earn some return, and that money can be used to meet the budget deficit when oil prices are low. So it insulates our economy and our budget from external shocks and from commodity price fluctuations. That's the budget development fund. Okay, budget development fund. But that short term, 3-4 years, we are talking about the cycles repeating. Let's understand that if we are the strategic thinkers of UAE and we see that our country is living and thriving on oil reserves, what if something odd happens and there's a permanent shift from oil to some other energy resource, or some other solar energy or electric vehicles or whatever it is? They vision that this might happen, that the world may not require oil that much. So how will our successors live? We need to ensure that our generations after generations, they are also able to live. So why do we live in so much of luxury? We should try to set aside some funds, and that fund can be invested globally into various asset classes, a big amount of fund, so that our future generations can live off, even if oil does not happen to be the major asset. So when you think about the intergenerational wealth transfer, that is savings fund. That's the fourth category. So I have not thrown the words at you as people do. I have tried to build a case for all such funds and tried to talk about it. So I started from India, that India requires a development fund to develop infrastructure. India seriously needs to think about a reserve fund to earn a decent return from its forex reserves, which China has done. Then I came to the oil-rich nations like Kuwait, like Russia, they have, Russia has double fund. Number one, it has a budget surplus, a stabilization fund to stabilize the budget that short term, and it has a savings fund to ensure that it is, its future generations are not going to survive or thrive based on what oil prices will be, but they can, they have some money which Russia has saved for the future generations. That's a savings fund. Finally, the fifth type of sovereign wealth fund is the pension reserve fund. All economies, irrespective of India, China, whatever, they will, and they are experiencing aging population. There are different stages of development. India is enjoying the young population, but still, it will also face aging population. So aging population needs to be provided with pensions for their livelihood. They need to be provided with healthcare benefits. So just as a company has to think about its employees, similarly a country has to think about social security payments to future generations. Okay. So the pension reserve fund is basically a pension fund, but not created by a company, but created by a country. You can think of it that way. To ensure that whatever shortfall remains, okay, that can be funded by the pension fund. So it's very easy to imagine the pension fund, because you have done pension, you have heard about pension fund for companies, so pension fund for countries. So there are five types of sovereign wealth funds. Okay, what are the types? Indian specific, I thought about development fund and reserve fund, okay, forex reserves. Oil wise, I thought about budget stabilization fund, short term versus savings fund, intergenerational wealth transfer. And finally, for employees, for aging population, I thought about pension fund. These are the five classifications. When you think about it this way, it will stay in your mind forever. Otherwise, you keep on creating acronym, okay, for learning the five types of fund. Like I was doing it in private wealth management at some places because some people required that support. I don't think acronyms are sustainable. They cannot remain forever in your mind. Okay. So let me show you the five types of funds classification given by IMF. Here we have the co-reading of the CFA Institute. SSEI has nothing to do with this material. This is CFA Institute material used in this COVID times, okay, to communicate. Along with this class, okay, there will be a PPT. There will be a PPT. For example, if people do not want to go through the co-readings, in that case, they can just go through the PPT where it is summarized as to whatever I'll discuss. But I cannot open the PPT and teach. That's not my style. Okay, and here also I'm opening the core. Why? Because I've spoken certain terminology. Okay, I've spoken certain terminology. So if you look at this exhibit 8, it's saying budget stabilization fund, development fund, savings fund, reserve fund, and pension reserve fund. Okay, it's also talking about the major types of funds, Saudi Arabian fund, Kuwait fund, Abu Dhabi fund, okay, Norway fund, and China fund. That's okay. So that's what they talk about. Now, if you wanted that, sir, you please provide some write-up. So here is the write-up. SWF, Sovereign Wealth Fund. These are state-owned. These are set up by the legislature, by the parliament, okay, set up by the legislature and are tax exempt in our country. Obviously, they have to pay taxes in foreign countries. So they are set up by the legislature, and obviously when the parliament will set up, it will have rules, regulations, how much money they can mop up, what are the sources of money, okay, where can they invest, what is their purpose, okay, what is the risk they can take, what is their horizon, how will their corporate governance take place, all that stuff is written. But when we say set up by legislature, the feeling should be clear. If we say that a particular institute, say the ICAI, is set up in India by the parliament, so ICAI has set up rules, sorry, parliament has set up rules for ICAI governing, na? So that way, anything set up by the legislature, there will be rules regarding where to mop up money, fund size, okay, the corporate governance structure and so on. And they are tax exempt because there is no sense that they will pay tax to the government. It is the government only, na? So you can't pay tax to yourself. Okay, obviously they have to pay tax in other countries. Then we have types of SWF. And how did I classify the types? I classified the types this way, three arrows. The first was, say, for India. The second was, the feeling was of oil. And the third was pension. So for India, I spoke about a budget stabilization fund to stabilize the budget short term. Okay. The second was savings fund. Sorry. The second was reserve fund for earning a good return on India's forex reserves. Okay, reserve fund. If you're copying, well and good. If you're not copying, that's your style of studying. Fine. Oil related. When I say oil, actually I mean commodity, but I'm writing oil because it just will click into your mind faster. There is a India, we do not have budget stabilization. For India, I spoke about development fund and reserve fund. Development fund and reserve fund, I'm sorry. When you repeat a number of times, you tend to make some mistake. Development fund to develop infrastructure and reserve fund to invest our forex reserves. Oil related, we had budget stabilization fund. Okay, the oil fluctuations causing surplus and deficit in the budget, short term. And your savings fund for intergenerational wealth transfer. Savings fund. Okay, our future generation should also be able to live. Savings fund by Russia, by Abu Dhabi, by Kuwait. Pension, we have the pension reserve fund. Okay, that's obvious from the name. New Zealand has it, China has it, pension reserve fund. Okay, so five types of funds. So this was a note starting sovereign wealth fund. Now, framework of this topic, framework. How has the author explained this? Now they've explained this via seven issues. They've explained it via seven issues. One is stakeholders. Who are the stakeholders? Second is liability and time horizon. Liability and time horizon. Third is liquidity. You understanding liability and time horizon for all the five types of fund, liquidity requirement for all the five types of fund, external constraints say, imposed by the parliament, external constraints, then investment objectives, and then asset allocation. So this is the framework that they've gone about. Six issues discussed. Stakeholders, who are the stakeholders? Liability and time horizon, liquidity, external constraints, investment objective, and asset allocation. Now this we have completed. What? External constraints. I'm putting a star over here and putting a star up over there, over here. Where I said no, they're set up by the legislature. That was the external constraint. So parliament will impose several constraints. Okay? Regarding the stakeholders also, it's not about a particular fund, it's about all sovereign wealth fund. Who are the stakeholders? The country's citizens, government, and the sovereign wealth fund management, the one who are managing, board of directors, and outside managers. So they have a fiduciary duty towards current and future generation. Okay? Stakeholders, citizens, government, SWF management, board of directors, and outside managers. So which means that this is over and this is over. External constraints. So now we have to discuss only four issues. Liability and time horizon, liquidity, investment objective, and asset allocation for each of the five types of sovereign wealth fund. Okay? Even before I start discussing, can't you guess that for the savings fund and the pension reserve fund. Okay, these two, savings fund and pension reserve fund, the liability, okay, the time horizon will be very long. The time horizon is very long and the liquidity requirements are minuscule. Okay, for these two. Actually, in pension reserve fund, it depends as to whether we are in the accumulation phase or the decumulation phase. So I'll elaborate all that. Okay, no issues. So these are the four things we need to discuss: liability and time horizon, liquidity, investment objectives, and asset allocation. Okay, as of now, I think the biggest sovereign wealth fund is that of China, around $1.5 trillion, followed by Abu Dhabi and Canada, both $1.2 trillion, followed by Norway, around $1 trillion. If I talk about asset size, is it required for the exam? No, it's just for inquisitiveness. In fact, the China sovereign wealth fund started in 2007, which means just at the time of the subprime crisis. So whatever investments it would have made across the globe, it would have made at rocket lower prices and then the upsurge. So they are always tactical. Whenever strategic also, they are tactical, it seems. Anyways, what can we say? So this was part one of our video, which gives you an idea. And part two, I'll discuss the four issues in all the types of funds. Thank you. So this is the second part of the video on sovereign wealth fund, CFA level 3. Let's discuss. So I had concluded the section earlier by explaining five types of funds that we have. And now we got to discuss what? Their liability and time horizon. If somebody has not listened to part one video, that person should immediately shut off this video. First listen to part one, then come to this. Okay, liability and time horizon, liquidity requirements, investment objectives, asset allocation. This is what we need to discuss for five types of funds. Okay, for five types of funds. Now before I start discussing, I should have said in part one itself, I forgot, for the entire sovereign wealth fund category, the liabilities are not well defined. Although we had learned everywhere that, sir, when we compare institutional investors with individual investors, for institutional investors they have well defined liabilities, individual investors they do not have well defined liabilities, remember? But sovereign wealth funds do not have well defined liabilities. Liabilities are not well defined. I just wanted to mention this because I forgot it in the part one section. Anyways, now let's come to the first one, a budget stabilization fund. Budget stabilization fund, hope you remember the feeling. The feeling is of oil. Sir, Russia, they had set up a budget stabilization fund. Why? Because oil prices are very volatile. When oil prices go up, Russia experiences a budget surplus. When oil prices go down, Russia experiences a budget deficit. So Russia's budget across time will represent a cyclical nature. It represents cyclical nature. So whenever they have a deficit, they have to charge more taxes and all. They have a surplus, they will charge less taxes. Such instability is not good. We want to convert this into possibly this pattern. Okay, we want to make it stable. So the purpose of budget stabilization fund is to stabilize the budget. Okay, so what is the objective? Objective as in, I'll write the objective twice, once in terms of the thematic objective, once in terms of investment objective, the way it should be written. Objective is to insulate the budget and economy from commodity and external shocks. Say the COVID shock. Okay, so to insulate the economy from commodity and external shocks. Now The main objective is capital preservation. Capital preservation. To earn a real rate of return, which is positive, real rate of return greater than equal to zero. I have written real rate of return, which means nominal rate of return should surpass inflation. Capital preservation, real rate of return greater than equal to zero. Okay, this is the objective. So we have completed the investment objective section. Okay, investment objective is over. Investment objective for budget stabilization fund is over. Now, what about liabilities and time horizon? Liabilities and time horizon. I have been dictating, okay? Hope you are writing. Otherwise, you'll have to manage from the PPT slides or through the core or through the summary. Now, liabilities are very uncertain because you never know what the budget would be. Very uncertain. Okay, because you don't know when there will be budget surplus or deficit. So whenever there's a deficit, we have to provide for. Whenever there's a surplus, we'll get some contribution. So it's very uncertain. Time horizon is short term. This is the only type of sovereign wealth fund. Time horizon is short term, say 2-3 years. 2-3 years. So accordingly, liquidity requirements are high. So I'm going to the next one. Liquidity requirements. Liquidity requirements high and uncertain. So when the liquidity requirements are high, the time horizon is short term, the risk tolerance level is low. So obviously, investments have to be made where? Investments have to be made in fixed income and in cash. So asset allocation. Asset allocation, fixed income and cash. They can't invest in equity too much. A small amount, say 5% is okay. Alternate investment is totally ruled out. They will invest in fixed income and cash. That too, high quality fixed income, short term perhaps, which can be quickly liquidated. Say government securities, which have high liquidity. So fixed income and cash. So that was your budget stabilization fund. Okay, budget stabilization fund is this one. Okay. Development fund. Okay. So development fund. Now when I explain development fund, I took the example of India. Let me write down development fund. I gave the feeling of infrastructure dash India. It will just help you to recap. So there's a need to develop a lot of infrastructure in India. The bond market over here is not developed. Private players cannot raise funds via the bond market. And banks are already risk averse. They are not ready to provide funds to the corporate sector that much. So what is the way out? The only way out is that the government has to take up the responsibility to develop infrastructure. And the government should set up a sovereign wealth fund for development of infrastructure. Now, if you try to look at the investment objective, when we were doing the economic growth in economics at level 2, we studied over there capital deepening. Remember capital deepening? So capital deepening and total factor productivity. I've talked about capital deepening moving along the curve. Growth by capital deepening takes place till the point MPK, marginal productivity of capital, exceeds the cost of capital. That is NPV is positive. Once MPK is equal to cost of capital, obviously NPV is zero and there is no rational in investing in infrastructure. So if I relate to that, the author has written that here the objective is not only capital preservation, the objective is to earn a real rate of return which is greater than LTEG. Is to earn a real rate of return which is greater than LTEG. We have to earn a real rate of return greater than LTEG. Please contrast this with budget stabilization fund, where the objective was to earn a positive real rate of return. That is nominal rate of return more than inflation. Here the objective is that real rate of return should be greater than the long-term economic growth rate. Okay, greater than the productivity growth. That's the objective. Okay. Let's start writing. So, development fund, investment objective to develop infra. Real rate of return, real rate of return greater than long term economic growth rate, LTEG. Okay, number two, liability and time horizon. Now, liability is to fund the project, to fund various infra projects, to fund various infra projects. Time horizon, generally long term, generally long term. I wrote generally because some projects may be short term, na? 4 years, 3 years, that's an exception, otherwise generally long term. But this is less long term as compared to the funds that we are going to do, the savings fund where intergenerational thing will be there. Okay. Number four, number three, liquidity requirement. Liquidity requirement is generally low. I've written generally low. Generally word is always attached. It's not very low. It depends on the projects. Number four, asset allocation. Depends on each project. So we cannot write that more investment in equity is required or more investment in AI is required. We can't write all that. It depends on the project. If the project is very long term, 30 years, obviously you can invest a lot in equity. You can also go for some AI. Okay, but if the project is not that long term, it will require regular contributions. You can't invest that way. So asset allocation depends on each project. That is the development fund. I believe that since already infrastructure is adequate in all the developed economies, so nobody gives importance to the development fund. Because who will set up a fund? Countries which are rich. Countries which are not rich. Anyways, they don't have money. Say India. So they can't set up the development fund. It is a fact, okay? If you understand what I'm saying, development fund is less important for the exam. Now we should come to the third one. Okay, once again, the third one. We'll come to the third one now. So let's move to the third category now, which is the savings fund. Okay, we have done the budget surplus fund, budget stabilization fund, development fund, and now savings fund. Okay, just one second, I'll just show you the screen. Savings fund. Now, savings fund, when I gave you the feeling of it, it was related to those oil nations, those commodity rich nations, or I should say, who have non-renewable resource. They are enjoying a luxury time because of that non-renewable resource. Think about all the oil rich nations in the 1960s, 70s, how they were enjoying as a result of the oil. But they should have felt that what if in future some alternate source of energy comes in, say solar energy, electric vehicles. In that case, what will happen to the future generations? So if they have that vision in their mind, they have their concern in the mind, they will definitely set up a savings fund, okay, a savings fund to provide for a good lifestyle to the future generations. Okay, it's like intergenerational wealth transfer going on. So savings fund is related to oil. Budget stabilization fund was also related to oil, but budget stabilization fund was short term. It was more of to ward off the oil price fluctuation. This one is very, very long term. In fact, the longest term out of all the categories, because it's for generational transfer. Okay, so that is savings fund. Let me write down point number one, investment objective. Provide funds out of non-renewable resources into diversified financial assets. Okay. So we are putting money in diversified financial assets, equity, alternate investments, and so on. Parachange. The target is to earn, or I should not dictate this, wait a minute. The target is capital preservation. We have to maintain the purchasing power of our portfolio, capital preservation, and a return required for government to carry out its responsibilities towards future generations. Towards future generations. Understood? So we have to preserve our capital and earn a return that is required. Okay. Number two, liability and time horizon. Now this one is easy. Liability is towards future generation. Future generation. Therefore, it's less well defined, I told you. Time horizon is long. It's very long. I should say very long. Time horizon. Because next generation, next generation. Number three. Liquidity requirements. Negligible. Obvious. There's no liquidity requirement. Liquidity requirement negligible. Okay. Therefore, asset allocation, anybody can guess. Asset allocation, we follow the endowment model. Okay, endowment model is a model where you allocate a significant portion to alternate investment, which is outsourced to outside managers. That's the endowment model. You allocate a major portion of your entire assets to alternate investments, which is managed by outside managers, outsourced to outside managers. I'm not dictating that. Endowment model, as in you allocate equity, major portion, AI, okay, major, fixed income and cash, minor. Within AI, you invest in private equity, hedge fund, okay, you move to all those categories. So this was your savings fund, okay, third category, savings fund. Let's go to the fourth one. So the fourth category that we have is reserve fund. Reserve fund. Now while explaining you the reserve fund, I gave the example of India. That India has forex reserves greater than $500 billion, and these reserves are held primarily in the form of safe US short term government securities, as in T-bills, which are yielding say 0.08%. To fund this, RBI has issued MSS bonds. We call them MSS over here, market stabilization scheme, but in the text it is called monetary stabilization bonds. So RBI or central bank has to pay interest on them, say 10%. And what is the central bank earning out of its forex reserves? 1%. So there's a negative cost of carry of 9%. So RBI has issued bonds paying 10%. And RBI is earning out of its assets, say 1%. So 9% is the negative cost of carry. That's too big. So this reserve fund is set up to reduce or eliminate the cost of carry, to earn a good rate of return by investing across the globe in risky assets. Across the globe in risky assets. That's a reserve fund. Understood? So, for the purpose of reserve fund, I gave you the example of India. Of course, India doesn't have such a fund. It was just the feeling. FX reserves India. Okay, just for the feeling of it. So, reserve fund. Number one, investment objective. Investment objective is to reduce, eliminate negative cost of carry and earn high return on ample FX reserves. This is the objective. Number two, liability and time horizon. So liability is towards monetary stabilization bonds, because you got to ensure that those bonds which have been issued to build the forex reserves, those bonds are met, they are redeemed, okay, towards monetary stabilization bonds. Time horizon is somewhere in between, as in we had the budgetary stabilization fund, you remember, the category one, and then we had the savings fund, this was category three. In between you have the reserve fund. So reserve funds have a long horizon, long, very long, and this is what, short. Are you understanding? Time horizon for the reserve fund is long, but it's less long as compared to savings fund, where intergeneration was involved, and it's obviously longer than the budget stabilization fund. Okay, reserve fund time horizon. Same thing for liquidity. So let's enjoy the same thing. Liquidity. Once again, you have the budget stabilization fund, you have the savings fund, and this is reserve fund. So in budget stabilization fund, the liquidity requirement is what? High requirement. In the savings fund, the liquidity requirement is low or negligible. I should write negligible better. Negligible. Over here it is low. So the liquidity requirement is somewhere in between the same. We will say low liquidity on an absolute basis, but when you compare, this is where you fit in. Please don't be worried about, sir, what about the development fund? I told you, development fund is actually not important for our curriculum because it is supposed to be set up by emerging market nations which lack poor infrastructure. That means they lack money. How will they set up the fund? Okay. Number four, asset allocation. Asset allocation, once again, same thing, equity, AI, fixed income and cash. If you will compare, obviously, they'll put more money, in equity and AI, but lesser than what we are putting in savings fund. Okay, so this is the reserve fund, forex reserves. So now we come to the last category, which is pension reserve fund. Pension reserve fund. So pension reserve fund, I said, is for all. All nations have aging population. At some point or the other, they will have to provide for their social security. They will have to provide for their retirement benefits. They will have to provide for their health care needs. So nations should build up a fund, just as companies built up a pension fund. Nations should build up a pension reserve fund to ensure that we are able to meet the payments towards the aging population. Okay, that's the pension reserve fund. So I will say that pension reserve fund is easy because you may think about pension fund by countries. Okay, by countries. Pension fund by countries. Okay, not formally but informally, when India has this in the form of the EPF or whatever it is called, pension reserve fund. Now pension reserve fund, the investment objective: generate return sufficient to meet pension payments and health care payments towards the aging population. Okay, that is the investment objective. We can't put a figure. Number two, liability and time horizon. So liability is towards aging population. We got to take care of them. Time horizon. Now, this is the number line. This is the accumulation phase where funds are accumulated, okay, to build up the fund and invested. And this is the decumulation phase where funds are to be paid to those who are aging. So in the accumulation phase, the time horizon is like long, say 10 years, 15 years left. Decumulation phase, it becomes what? Short. So short over here, long over here. This distinction is very important. Anybody doing pension reserve fund, he doesn't know accumulation phase, decumulation phase, he will not be able to get marks in the exam. The examiner will wait for you to communicate accumulation, decumulation phase. Number three, same thing, liquidity requirement. Liquidity requirement. I'll once again mark the same thing, number line. This is the accumulation phase and this is the decumulation phase. So over here, liquidity requirement is low. There is no liquidity requirement. Low, very low, not there. Over here, liquidity requirement is what? High, because we are paying the, we are making the payments towards the aging population. So decumulation phase, the liquidity requirement is high. Number four, asset allocation. Now once again, accumulation phase, decumulation phase. In the accumulation phase, the asset allocation is more towards equity and AI. Over here, less towards equity and AI. Over here, in the decumulation phase, it's more towards liquid fixed income securities, which can be easily liquidated. Okay, so I think the crux of the pension reserve fund was about the accumulation and decumulation phase. That was the crux which you got to remember. Okay, I think we'll look at an example. One example is given. Let's have a look at the example. So here is the core, and I'm trying to search the example which is there. Yeah, this is the example. Example number four. Example number four. The People's Fund of Vegetania, a pension reserve fund. The People's Fund is a pension reserve fund established by the government of Vegetania by setting aside current government surpluses. Its objective is to meet future unfunded social security payments caused by an aging population. The following is an extract from the People's Fund IPS. Effective from 2030, government will have the ability to withdraw assets to meet pension and social security liabilities falling due each year. So the decumulation phase will start beyond 2030. Till 2030, we have the accumulation phase. Actuarial projections estimate annual payouts to be about 5% of total funds value at that time. 5% of fund value required at that time. That may come from dividend, interest, or liquidation of the holdings. Given this level of cash flow, the fund is expected to maintain most of its asset base for the foreseeable future. As such, liquidity profile may change. It will change actually. What are the liquidity needs of the People's Fund? So liquidity needs in the accumulation phase nil, liquidity needs in the decumulation phase high. Okay, that's the answer. I'm talking about the substance of the answer, not the posh language that's going to accompany it. Number two, what factors did the board need to consider while reviewing the fund's investment horizon? The board needs to consider a multi-phased investment horizon, two stages, accumulation phase, decumulation phase. So all that we have studied in difference between institutional and individual IPS bends over here, no? Because we had studied institutions have a single time, long-term time horizon. Here they are two time horizon. Okay, we had studied institutions have a well-defined liability. Here we don't have well-defined liability. Okay, so I think sovereign wealth fund represents a separate status in the class of institutional investors. And I also forgot to mention something. You may go to your notes, please. I don't have the slide. You may go to your notes. I had mentioned in the first portion where I had dictated that it is set up by legislation and it is tax exempt. Can you find that? It is set up by legislation and tax exempt. There you need to just mention that they follow the GAAP principles, GAPP, GAAP principles, generally accepted principles, coined by the, what is the name? Let me just check out. Okay, just one second. Tax and accounting. Yeah, by Santiago principles. They follow the Santiago principles. Okay, Santiago principles is what they have said. So there might be some sovereign wealth fund principles, Santiago principles, that is followed by them. Okay, compliance with Santiago principles, external constraints. External constraints set up by legislation. So whatever legislation rules are there, they have to follow. They are tax exempt, so accordingly investments have to be made and they have to comply with the Santiago principles. Okay, I don't know what Santiago principles are there. Okay, but you just don't got to remember Santiago principles. Okay, so that was all about sovereign wealth fund. Okay, hope you understood. Please do read the PowerPoint slides attached to this, and the summary is very good. In fact, I'm including the summary as a part of the PowerPoint slides, so that when you read the summary towards the end, you feel that yes, I know, it's comfortable. Okay, thank you.